Hello and welcome to Physics Office Hours. I'm Eric, and in this episode, we are going over the uncertainty principle. If you like physics, always feel free to stop by my stream. I stream at twitch.tv/physicsoh every Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. Link in description. Without further ado, roll the intro. All right, so let's do the uncertainty principle. We've been talking about it here and there for a while. There is one thing I'm gonna have you guys take for granted. One step. There is solutions online, you can find them. It's in my textbook, it's as a homework problem, and I did the homework problem but couldn't find it, and honestly it was like, I was willing to be like, okay, I'll take this for what it's the face value. So, the uncertainty principle. I'm gonna, I gotta lower that. We'll say uncertainty relations. I actually don't know. The uncertainty principle we'll deal with in a second anyways. We're gonna talk more about uncertainty relations, and then we'll do the uncertainty principle at the very end, okay? And then by then, I'll figure out how to spell it. Okay. So here's, someone made the comment in chat, okay? And this is a very important comment to have. And we're gonna talk about, and that's kind of what drives the whole thing. And that is that this relationship right here. Remember, if you guys don't know this stuff, look at, I have VODs up about it. If you're interested in learning it, you might just be able to Wikipedia it for a faster result. Okay, but this is a commutation relation. And if you remember, it just means, this particular side of it just means that A, B, and I have hats because they're operators. And operators in physics and quantum mechanics are like matrices that have certain properties to them. So this is I, the imaginary number, and then C hat. So this means that like if you just change the order of these and subtract the two, that it does not equal zero. These are just multiplied together, right? Most of the time, if you have two numbers, right? Like 2 and 3, 2 times 3, 3 minus 3 times 2 is gonna be zero every time. Right? But there's certain things you can do here that make it so that it's not zero if you just switch the order. Okay? That's the weird thing. That's one of the weird things about this. Is this commutation relation. But this is kind of the key right here. Someone said in chat, it was either, I think it was either NC or RPG, that, is that on? Yeah, it's on. Yeah, it's on. Is that this implies, and we're gonna break this apart, but this implies the uncertainty, or fundamental uncertainty. Fundamental uncertainty relation. Okay? Is that you get this commutivity property where you have an I times another number, operator, whatever, then you have a fundamental uncertainty relation. So here's the thing you guys have to take for granted. So keep this in the back of your mind. This is where we're gonna build everything off of, but I have to do a couple of things. Well, actually, let's hold off on that. Let me introduce a state, okay? Most of you don't know what a state is, but it's very, very important that we understand what a state is. So let's see, what's a state look like? And then we'll talk about what it is in a second. So we could say, you know, C plus is just a number. We call it a probability amplitude. And then we'll say this one from the last video where we did the Stern-Gerlach experiment, we have, you know, Z plus is gonna be like the oriented and spinning up. And then we could have some probability amplitude and the state, which is Z minus, which is basically spin oriented down. Now I'm gonna say a couple things. I'm gonna say a couple things about like the, what states are, but they are not the most physical, I should say like mathematically correct, physical formalism correct. These are just ways of understanding what things are. So you have to like actually like pick up texts and read the actual definitions if you want to know what the mathematically correct definition is. But this is for somewhat, this is basically how I want to describe what a state is. And then anybody who knows more about this in chat, you know, NC, RPG, Justin, PhysicsOH, whoever wants to chime in and say like, you know, it means something like this, that's fine. That's, I highly recommend it. But this is my, I don't know what a quantum state is. So here, we have two types, okay? We have basis states. And then we have, and there's more types than this, but we're just gonna talk about this, where we have basis states, and then we have general states. And a general state is just being like a generic general. I mean, general is in like, it can be whatever. So it's psi. Psi is the general state, okay? Inside the general state, you'll have what's called basis states, okay? So a general state might just be a linear combination of basis states. So we just have a linear combination of basis states. Right now, for this one particular, we just have two. This example, we're always just going to have two, okay? What's a basis state? Again, this is just an ad hoc definition, okay? A basis state is a possible classical state before measurement. Because that's Washington State. Oh, clever. I get it now. That's clever, NC. I like that. But yeah, so basis state, again, is just going to be a possible classical state before measurement. So what does that mean? That just means, again, this is the state spin up. This is the particle spin up. This is the state spin down, okay? But the particle is not measured, so we don't know what state it's in. We know that it's in a combination of all of the states until we measure it. And then it will snap into one of the states, the basis states, and then we have, you know, we can take a measurement. If you get a few weeks into quantum mechanics in undergraduate, you realize that there's a lot more to it, that this is not exactly how it is, but for our general purposes, we can just say it's that, okay? All right, so what are these called? Well, this is called a ket, so we can talk about bras and kets really quick. A bra would look like this, and a ket would look like this. So anytime that this is pointed this way, maybe I should have done it like this. This would be for our generalized state, or general state. Bras and kets, okay? It's Dirac notation is what we call it. This is something that Dirac came up with. All right. Now, with this in mind, we can talk about a few things, like the Schwarz inequality. This is the thing I need you guys to take for granted. We're gonna write it up top because it's probably gonna be there for the rest of the time. And it's going to be alpha, the bra alpha, which again is some generalized state. So for the record, pretty much everything is generalized state unless I say otherwise. Because generalized states can obviously be basis states as well. And then we can do some sort of beta. Like I said, that's not the best definition if you want to get into the nitty gritty, but it will do. So if you take this bra and ket of alpha and multiply it by the bra and ket of beta, then you'll get this that is going to be greater than or equal to the bras and kets of alpha and beta squared, okay? So, we've seen states, right? Talked about states, what they are. The basis, you know, some general state is the linear combination of basis states, where we have probability amplitudes attached to each basis state, okay? But what does this mean when we start doing something like that? Or how do we sandwich operators in between states? So we could talk about, first let's talk about alpha and beta. Let me write them down. Alpha we'll just write as the following. There's some operator A minus some average of A, which is just the average over all the pieces of A. And that we're gonna apply to some general state psi. Okay, so that's gonna be our alpha. So it's a general state, because there's a general state here. And we're gonna say that we apply some operator alpha, or A, and we just subtract the average of A from each individual piece. This is a whole thing is a matrix, right? It's just each element of the matrix is subtracted from this A or whatnot. Or it should say the diagonals, because you could multiply it by the identity matrix. But we can say this is a matrix nonetheless. Okay, alpha is this, beta is B minus, you know, some, anyways, average of B times the state. I'm trying so hard not to use, like, different, difficult terms, like expectation values. But what is the expectation value? What is this average? And in broad cat notation, we can handle it, right? We can say that the average over A is equal to sandwiching that A operator in between two of our generalized states. So we'll take psi on both sides of A, and that gives us the average over the A, okay? Our expectation value. This is where some statistics would come in handy. If anybody's taking statistics classes, expectation value, standard deviations, we're gonna talk about all of it, okay? And now we'll take this other state and we'll sandwich it between B, and that's just how we find the expectation value of B, okay? This is all first few days of quantum mechanics class. This is what you'll do, okay? Now each state you could represent, well, we'll talk about them in a minute, okay? So lastly, we gotta talk about one more thing, which is the uncertainty. And uncertainty, we can sort of define that as delta A. And in statistics, you might find the delta A as something that looks like this. And again, I'm not gonna prove this, but you can prove it. It's not too difficult to prove, I don't think. Every like statistics book would have some sort of proof of this, as well as quantum mechanical book will have the same type of proof, but they'll all be done in bracket notation usually. But basically we can boil this down to as the uncertainty is given by the, hold on, let me finish writing it so I can read it. But the uncertainty of some variable A, okay, is given by the value of the square root of the average of the standard deviation squared minus the squared average of A. Okay? Oh, sorry. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't dropped any frames, so I'm pretty good on this side, I think. So the same thing applies for B, right? And that's just what the uncertainty is. Now, let's do a little quick example. So let's erase everything. I think my eraser might be a little bit too wet. Yeah. I cleaned it because it was like crushing me with how much chalk dust was in it. If I have to write any of this back, I will. We're gonna leave this up here though. Okay? But so far we've just sort of, this is where we're at. We got the uncertainty written down. Okay? And uncertainty is basically how well we can actually know something, okay? So now let's talk about, let's do an example, okay? And we'll get everything back. SZ is the spin in the Z direction. It's the spin angular momentum of something spinning. And we used it in the Stern-Gerlach experiment. So let's write that down as a matrix. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the matrix notation, this is actually Pauli notation. Pauli and Dirac both kind of came up with formalism for quantum mechanics roughly around the same time. One decided to do bras and kets, and one decided to do matrices. The bras and kets are a little neater, but you got to know what they mean. It's like learning a language. So we can talk about the z state as being a vector 1, 0, and z plus, that is, and the z minus state being a vector 0, 1. Now, how do we actually use this stuff? Well, let's start with our generalized state again. Now we're going to be kind of specific to being the generalized state of the particles that we were talking about the inside of the Stern-Gerlach machine, okay? Which we have C plus, the probability amplitude, times the basis state, plus C minus times this basis state. And that's a generalized state. So any particle going through the apparatus will have this state, and then once it gets measured by the magnets are the things doing the measuring, then it will either go up to Z plus or down to Z minus, and we'll get sort of like a classical, roughly classic, obviously there's some, again, subtleties with that, but we'll get some sort of classical idea of what's going on. And then we can talk about the expectation value, or the average, but expectation value is probably the better term. And we can sandwich that between some psi states. And what's that going to look like? Well, we should talk sort of quickly about what it looks like, what the bras look like. This is a cat. The bra of this exact thing is going to be the complex conjugate of that state. So for instance, so that's going to be the bra. These are all cats, so this is the bra, and it's just gonna look like this, where you sort of just take the complex conjugate form of C. What am I doing? Oh yeah, times the bra Z plus, you know, plus C, plus minus, there we go. Complex conjugate of Z minus, okay? Good. So what happens if we apply this S matrix in between the two of them? And you know, if you're not comfortable with the bras and cats, you can do the matrices if that's how you're more comfortable. But we can sort of skip all that. That's just some fancy multiplication. And basically what you can see is these numbers are really numbers, okay? They might be complex numbers, but they are numbers. So they commute, they can come in and out, they can do all sorts of stuff. But if we put this guy here, if we put this in the middle, and then we'll put this on this end, we'll end up getting something similar to this, right? We'll get h bar over 2 times c plus conjugate times c plus times the state z plus with a bracket minus z minus complex conjugate z plus, or I'm sorry, z minus normal times h bar over 2. I kind of forgot that, so we'll throw that in there. And then z minus times z minus. Now, if you know anything about vectors, you can kind of consider this as an inner dot product, and inner dot products between the same thing is going to take it to 1. Okay, so that's going to be 1. You can also think of it as being as orthogonal or whatnot, or parallel, I mean. So if all those go to 1, we can rewrite this as basically h bar over 2 times c conjugate plus minus c minus conjugate C minus. Okay? So that's the expectation value for SC. Well, what does that look like for like the Stern-Gerlach? So let's talk about the Stern-Gerlach real quick. Okay? Well, we can sort of see that if the Stern-Gerlach was half probability up and half probability down, then the vectors are normalized. Okay. Fair enough. That's fair. That's fair. Vectors are normalized. Well, we're not going to normalize anything. Because we're just going to assume everything's normalized. Fancy. Okay, so in the Stern-Gerlach, there was a half probability that things would go up and a half probability that things would go down. So that means that these C numbers, when you multiply the two of them together, is going to be a 1/2, because the probability amplitude is only half of the probability. The probability is the amplitude times the complex conjugate of the amplitude. Okay, so the probability that a particle will spin up or spin down is based off of the complex conjugate times the amplitude. The complex conjugate of the probability amplitude times the probability amplitude itself. So, if we were to talk about the SG, where the probability is 1/2, then we can see that this is going to be 0, right? 1/2 minus 1/2. But this isn't the end all for our delta A is the square root of the standard deviation squared minus the average squared. So obviously the square of 0 is 0, so even this part right here is going to be 0, but what is this? Well, let's square the matrix and find out. Our matrix, if we square the matrix, SZ squared is equal to, well, you square the front, h bar squared over 4, times 1, 0, 0, minus 1, 1, 0, 0, minus 1. Do your little matrix multiplication. You get 1 in the top. H bar squared over 4. You get 1, 0, 0, 1. You get the identity matrix. So now what does this look like? Well, this SZ, when it applies to this state, when it applies to either of the state, it gives you this minus because of this. But if that minus is gone, now it's plus, then if you were to do this, the average of, oops, I almost wrote A again, SZ squared, then you're going to get h bar squared over 4 times C plus complex conjugate times C plus plus C, whew, lost my jaw. Curses. C minus complex conjugate, C minus. Now the reason these aren't squared is because these are part of the state. The state's not squared. See, the C's are on the states, right? But the ZC is the one that's squared, and that does not have any C's in it. So the C's don't change, but this front gets squared. So what happens if we, so it's basically going to be this number, which is going to be H bar squared over 4, right? H bar squared over 4 minus 0. So now we can take the square root of that. And, well, yeah, we could do that if we wanted. But, yeah, so we could write that out. Let's write that out just for clarity. SC is equal to H bar over 2. Okay? So that's an example of all of this stuff. Now, where do we go from here? We have the square minus the square of the mean is what I usually confuse. Mean of the square minus the square of the mean is what I usually confusingly say. Yeah, it's not the easiest thing to say that, but that is, it is true. Okay, so now remember, or recall, or remember, let's rewrite the states really quick. Alpha is equal to and beta. B times our psi. So now we can start doing the same thing that we did before, okay? What's alpha bra times alpha cap? Well, first things first is we need to talk a little bit about A and B. Not much. But we can just say that A and B are Hermitian. What does Hermitian mean? Hermitian means that it's equal to its adjoint. The adjoint is the complex conjugate and transpose, okay? It's one of the very popular things in physics, in quantum mechanics. You use adjoints a lot, and we say that these things are Hermitian. Oh, we'll make it big. Okay? So maybe if you want to see that really quick. How are we doing on time? I think we're good on time, right? Oh, yeah. We're killing it with time. Oh, I love blackboards. Not forced at all. Love this thing. I've had this thing for years. Make sure the chalkboard eraser fully dries before you erase with it, or even impossible to erase smear paste on the board. Okay, I will. Yeah, this is a little bit different, but I think that's the same thing. I got like some sort of chalkboard cleaner my wife got me too. It's awesome. It works really well. Okay, so C, the operator C, you can write it as C minus C, C and C. And then you can just say, okay, so if this is just some operator C, where these are, you know, just values, we can call them probability amplitudes or whatever, or, yeah, they're not probability amplitudes, you just call them numbers, complex numbers. So then if they're complex numbers, then we could say that the C dagger is going to be the complex conjugate, where you make every single one of these complex numbers conjugated. But then the transpose flips all the diagonals. So since this is minus up here, this is now minus down here because we flipped these two, and then we conjugated it. Okay? So that's just what the dagger is. For those of you who know some linear algebra. So now, this is the part of my notes where they kind of, I missed something major. We have to write something down. So we write this down, okay? What do alpha, and beta look like? Because this is going to be the left-hand side of our Schwarzschild equation, okay? So what do they look like? This is not a proof that this is correct. This is correct, okay? You have to figure out, we're gonna show some more stuff, okay? We have to assume that this is correct. You can do this, you can find this proof online, or you can do it yourself as a fun exercise. I had to do it as an undergraduate. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this and we're going to do the same thing. These are the states, so we're going to flip it, apply the complex conjugate. There's a nice notation for writing that. It's just, these are Hermitian, so the complex conjugate actually equals itself anyways. Since this is a number, when you apply the complex conjugate to each of these things, or I'm sorry, the adjoint to each of these things, then you'll find out that this is a number, so it's the same thing. And then this is a Hermitian, so it's the same thing. Okay, so it'll be squared, because you get one for each state, okay? And then same thing here, except for B's. So this is the part that I'm missing in my notes. So this is the one hand side. This is the one hand side of the equation. Well, we can write the other side of it as well. Obviously, A and B is equal to. I mean, them just multiplied, squared, squared, good. So them just multiplied by each other. So minus A squared. Oh no, not squared. We talked about this. To go to school and get more chalk. Because I can't find Prang in the stores. What did I do? I double stated. That's an overstatement. Okay. Good. So now, what does this mean? Well, this is the left-hand side, this times this, right? And then this is the right-hand side, over there. So let's try to break this one down a little bit. And what do we get? Well, firstly, actually, before we go any farther, but I found it. Okay, this is equal to delta A squared and delta B squared. Okay, I knew that, I just couldn't find it in my notes. And I didn't know if there was something in the middle, but there's not. So this is, we can say that this is the same thing as, you know, obviously you're going to apply these to this, it's gonna be a number, it's not gonna matter, you're gonna apply this to this, and you're gonna get the delta A. So, we're good. This is correct. This, if you do this, you'll get this, you'll get this. Everything is good. Okay. So this is the left-hand side. We have to consider that the left-hand side is going to look like this. Delta A squared times delta B squared. Okay? From here. So now let's do the right-hand side of the Schwarz, the Schwarz inequality. All right, so I'm gonna erase everything, I think, because I want more room to do this. There is a rule for any operator that has a complex conjugate, and that is that you can express any operator in the following way. You can express some operator O as, well, firstly, I'm sorry, hold on. Firstly, you can let O be, we're gonna let O be some operator, and it's gonna be A minus the average of A times, this is an operator. We know that this is an operator, okay? So now we're interested in finding the middle term of that Schwarz, of this, which we laid out, okay? So we're just gonna say, okay, it's gonna be some operator, right? Well, what can you do with that operator? Well, here's something you can do with any operator. Any operator in general, you can write it as, this is what I was finding, I lost it in my notes, but I found it now. You can write it as this. The operator times this, or plus its adjoint over two. This operator itself equals this operator plus the adjoint of the operator over two, plus the operator minus the operator adjoint over two. Okay. So now we're gonna simplify this. We're gonna say let F be equal to O plus O adjoint, and let G, F and G are now just operators again, we're setting them equal to more operators, be some negative I times O minus O dagger. Okay, now F and G are Hermitian, you can do that calculation on your own if you'd like, but they are Hermitian. Okay, let me go right over here, Hermitian, very sloppily. Okay, no one can read it, but it's written there, believe me. Okay. So now we're gonna say, okay, well, our operator is gonna be this. Okay, because this is for all operators. So our operator is this. Well, what do we do? Let's look at this term. Well, if we were to write it all out, O minus O dagger is equal to A minus the average of A times B minus the average of B. expectation value be, minus A minus expectation of A, B minus expectation of B, the whole thing, dagger. Okay? The dagger is here, so it applies to the whole thing. Well, there's a rule in this stuff. Hello, welcome. Oh, I'm missing a lot of stuff. I will get back to all your questions in a little bit. Yes, A is, I did say a little earlier, but I kind of passed over kind of quickly. This A is actually times, it is a number, but it's also times the identity operator, which we don't usually write because it's just one, but yeah. It is the identity operator, which has the, for all intents and purposes, for what we do here. Rant by Bowser. Bowser's finding his identity. So one thing we have for mathematics is if you take the transpose of A times B, or I'm sorry, the dagger, the adjoint of A times B, you get this, B adjoint times A adjoint. You swap the order and you take the adjoint of the individual ones. Again, an exercise to the watcher if they want to see. Okay. It's a pretty generic thing you learn in linear algebra. But what does that mean for here? Well, that means we're gonna flip this and take the adjoint of each and one individually. So this is going to be A minus the expectation of A, B minus the expectation of B, minus, and then we'll get B, and also you can apply it inside to each one, so it'll be B dagger minus, this is a number times identity matrix, it's Hermitian, the identity matrix is obviously Hermitian, so that's just gonna be that again. And then A dagger minus A. But again, we have this thing where these are Hermitian. So these are, so A is Hermitian and B is Hermitian. So now what happens to this is we can do all the multiplication out. We can substitute these in with their normal parts. Okay, got them all the hats. So what does that mean? So that means, down here, welcome to physics office hours. We're doing the uncertainty principle. Take a knee, guys. Okay, so A, B, minus expectation value of A times operator B, sorry, that was a little sloppy, minus the expectation value of B times the operator A, plus expectation of A and expectation of B, minus the quantity of B, A, minus, oops, the expectation of A times B, minus the expectation of B times A, plus expectation of A, expectation of B. But now you have this, which are numbers times operators, or numbers times identity, sorry. And you have this, which is number times identity. It's this times this, so this goes away. This minus, plus this, this minus BA plus BA goes away. And what are you left with? Or the commutator. Of A, B, which, like we said, is equal to IC. Now, what do we show? Well, we show that this, if you do all the math, you get the commutator between A and B, and you get IC. Okay? Well, what's this? That's IG. I bleeding? Oh, I'm kind of bleeding a little bit. That's no good. Okay. So what do we do now? So C is equal to G. So let's rewrite this, okay? This, get rid of this. We just picked some operator O. We saw that there's a relationship between all operators O. And we picked one thing to kind of look at, and we saw that we can go back to the G that we picked, and we found out, oh, this is a different C. I should get rid of this. That was just some generic C. Sorry, guys. That's not the same C. That was a poor choice of variable. Should change that in my notes. Okay. Okay, so again, we're back to here. Okay? If you recall, this had, you know, the states with that in the middle. And what we can do is rewrite this. I gotta get down a step because I didn't give myself enough room. And we can write this as, let's write the whole thing out real quick. We have time. I wanna get to your comments and stuff in just a second, but we got plenty of time. This is going very swimmingly, I'd say. Oh, I don't have it in my notes. I have it in the book. Very good. Oh, I did it. Never mind. Let's just do it. No, not yet. Not yet, friend. I should just look at the book. It's right in front of my face, but I just won't look. Now we do the state. Well, we can split this up as we saw. We already multiplied everything together. It's pretty easy to see that you can split this up and it'll look like something like this, where we have our Fs and our Fs and our Gs. We said that this was O, right? That this whole term was O, and that O was this. Remember, we set that equal to O, and that O was... No, hold on, not there yet. Went back one too many pages. Oh, so we had the 1 half. Let's see, so we have... We can pull out a 1 half. It's squared now. So we can pull out a 1 half. We're still going to square it. Give me just a second. Oh, so this whole thing is squared. I should be clear about that. 1 half times the state of f. That's where that half comes from the f. Plus the I over 2, because that was attached to the g. But now we're not doing g anymore because we found out the g is equal to c. So we're gonna keep that c that we had originally. Remember, this is the correct form of c that we wanna stick with. So now we're talking about this c here, which we proved already. And what does this mean? Well, this means that this is equal to this plus this. Well, this is some number, okay? There's nothing in this that we haven't figured out that this is just some number. So what does this mean? And then you can complex conjugate it, so this is gonna be a plus number as well. But anyways, nevertheless, this is gonna be some positive number. Well, if this is a positive number, then this means that this must be greater than or equal to what? Oh, let's finish this. I'm sorry. Let's finish it properly. Yeah. Sorry. I'm getting ahead of myself here. Let's simplify this and we get the state over F. We're going to apply the complex conjugation just to show you for sure that this is going to be plus, because this will always, the complex conjugation squared will always make it plus over 4 plus. It's the eigenvalues that make it not plus, but this one is plus. Squared over 4. This is now, what is this? We've talked about this in the past too. This is the expectation value of C. Remember how we said if it's sandwiched in between two psi states, it's the expectation value. And that's going to be squared over 4. It's, this is clearly greater than or equal to this, because this is just this side, right? And then this is some positive number. So this side is clearly going to be greater than this side. So this is clearly going to be greater or equal to this. What does that mean? Well, that means that this is greater than or equal to this, which is greater than or equal to this. Why does that matter? Remember when we first started talking about Poisson brackets? Bye, Kurt. Sorry, I probably missed you. Why is this important? Do you remember when we went all the way back when we did the Poisson brackets and everything? What was one of the identities that we talked about? This was one of the ones where we did when we talked about going from classical to quantum, right? We showed that if you do the commutator of the X and P's, and we can break this down and go into more and more detail. We probably even have time where I can at least just write them down. If you want to do the math, you can do that on your own. Again, it's a little bit calculational heavy. Let me find the definitions really quickly. Well, we could write it as the creation and annihilation, or raising and lowering operators. I'll just give you something to do. Oops. A plus a dagger. There's probably easier forms to deal with this. H bar over 2 times a minus a dagger. We can do a whole nother day on this stuff. But these basically just raise and lower the states. You can do that as, again, as an exercise. But nevertheless, like, this is true. We talked about it at the beginning. What does that mean? Well, this takes the same shape as this. So can we relate that? Sure we can. Ready? Goes something like this. Delta A, delta B, we can take the square root of both sides and get, you know, C over 2, right? So how does that translate? Delta X, PX. C is gonna be, instead of like an operator here, it's just gonna be the identity and times H. So it's just going to be H bar over 2. Because we don't carry the I. Notice the I doesn't make it down. So the I from here doesn't make it down either. So it's just H bar over 2. And that's it. We've proved that any commutator that has this relationship is going to be subject to some uncertainty relation. This uncertainty relation, to be more exact. And position and momentum as observables have some uncertainty to them that follows this exact way. Now you might say to yourself, like, okay, this is kind of odd. Like, I have this bye Tyrion, sorry I missed you too. missing everybody, going bye. But yeah, so like you might say to yourself, okay, well, that doesn't make any sense to me. I don't know what this means. But this is just, we have set up the position and the momentum in a way where we can evaluate them using states, using matrices and all, and that is correct. As much as you want to say, like, okay, something is wrong in the setup, we've done good calculations with this. Like, this is right. If you do it this way, you have to accept this is true. Well, this is true, regardless. But then you also have to accept that this matches some form of this, namely this, which means that if you want to find these are measurables for observables. You're trying to measure something, right? So what does that mean? Like, the more that you measure this, the more uncertain you are about this. The more that you manage the position, the more uncertain you are about the, the position, or the more you measure the position, the more uncertain you are about the momentum. You can never have an answer for both of these, because if it was both of them, this would be equal to zero. Then we'll always have something where there's always going to be some lower threshold of some type of uncertainty between these two variables. Okay? And you can do this with another one. Try to break this rule. Try to say, well, these commute. Then what happens? Well, then what happens is you get a whole lot of mess. Well, actually, I think you just get zero. They commute. So it's not really a whole lot of mess. It's probably a lot easier. All right. Now I've been kind of ignoring. So I'm going to take a look and see where you're at. Geek, how are you? How are you doing today?